honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is yet another Dhamma on Air, this time a special edition devoted entirely to the core theory in early Buddhism of causality, of cause and effect, dependent origination, paticca-samuppada in Pali. So everything has a cause and everything has an effect. Actually, it has multiple causes and multiple effects, but this we will speak to in a minute, and you are indeed welcome. Thank you.
Friends, on the essential and crucial foundation for all mental purity, the blessed Buddha once said this. Bhikkhus and friends, there are these four foundations of awareness. What for? When a bhikkhu keenly contemplates, one, any body, just as a transient form, two, any feeling, just as a passing sensation. 3. Any mind, just as a momentary mood. 4. Any phenomena, just as a flickering mental state. While always acutely aware and clearly comprehending, he thereby removes any urge, envy, jealousy, frustration, and discontent rooted in this world. These are the four foundations of awareness. How, friends, does one view any body only as a form, while always acutely alert and clearly comprehending, thus removing any lust, urge, envy, frustration and discontent rooted in this world? Yeah, intelligent bhikkhu, he keeps contemplating and regarding any body as an alien frame of filthy, foul form, as something bound to emerge, decay, and vanish, not as mine, belonging to me, or being a part of myself. In this way, the intelligent bhikkhu keeps reviewing any and all body, whether internal or external, whether his own or others, and he notes the cause of its arising and the cause of its ceasing, or he just knows there is this body. In this way he comes to live not clinging to and independent of anybody. This is one way to contemplate it. The body only as a transient form. Another way is to gain awareness of the body only as a form by awareness of breathing. Or he gains awareness of the body by noting the four postures when walking, standing, sitting or lying down. He notes this is walking, standing, sitting, lying down. However his body is placed, he notes it to be exactly so. Or he gains awareness by clear comprehensions of all actions. When walking, one understands this body is walking. When standing, one knows this body is standing. If sitting, one notes this body is sitting down. When lying down, one reflects this body is lying down. When moving forward or returning, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When looking forward or backward, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When bending or extending a limb, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When dressing or carrying things, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When eating, drinking, chewing or tasting, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When defecating or urinating, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When walking, standing or sitting, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When falling asleep or waking up, one clearly comprehends exactly that. When talking or dwelling in silence, one clearly comprehends exactly that. Or one gains awareness of the body by scanning the 32 internal organs. Or one gains body awareness by analysis of it into the four great elements. This body is only a cluster of solidity, fluidity, heat and motion. Or one gains body awareness by the nine corpse contemplations, remaining thus attentive and enthusiastically noting any memories or motivations related to the household life are left. And with their total removal, one's mind gathers, settles inwardly, and dives into unification. In this way, the intelligent bhikkhu keeps reviewing any and all body, whether internal or external, whether own or others, and he notes the cause of its arising and the cause of its ceasing. Or he just noticed there is a spot. In this way, he comes to live not clinging to and independent of any body. This is the way to contemplate the body only as a transient, alien, remote, an ownerless frame of form, a complex structure of disgusting things, a constructed accumulation of putrid, rotting and decaying slime, and a painful, restricting and diseasing burden one have to carry around. This is how the intelligent bhikkhu develops mindfulness, awareness, by focusing on the body as a deadly form of matter, as something bound to decay and vanish, not as mine, not belonging to me, or not belonging to a self, not as lasting, stable or safe, not as pleasant beauty or happiness, not as pleasant beauty or any form of happiness. The reward is fearlessness of death, and thereby fearlessness of all. Without fear, there is the mental elation of gladness and free joy. It detaches and relinquishes from body and form, and thereby it frees. One sees this body just as a painted puppet, a chain of bones plastered by skin with nine oozing holes, a heap of sores and rotten excrement with evil intentions. Just as a painted puppet. This is how one gains awareness, by noting the body only as a full frame. This is from the group sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 5, Chapter 47, on the foundations of awareness, Satipatthana. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air special on Paticchasamuppada, and you are indeed welcome about this exposition of causality or dependent origination. First of all, remember to click subscribe there if you haven't clicked subscribed, and you have clicked subscribe, click the small bell there so you get notified, and click like if you like.
wonderful day out in the forest here in May on Værhøj. It means the hill of the weather here in western Denmark, close to the ocean. It is in May and we are approaching Vesak Day. Vesak Day is a full moon in May, and this would be the 18th May here in 2019. But let's go straight to the subject, Paticca Samuppada, the chain of dependent origination. It is a subject that is as deep as they come, and it is a shared ground tenet between Western science, which also is based on causality, that no phenomena is purely random. It arises from a cause, and this cause has an effect. And the purpose of science is finding the relation between the cause and the effect. You can say, to some extent, that the same goes for Buddhism. It is also based on cause and effect. And the whole deal is to find the relation between the cause of suffering and thereby the cause of the absence of suffering and thereby the cause of happiness, which is the same thing, basically. So it is something that is very central to early Buddhism, that the Buddha comes back to again and again. And actually there's a whole book in called the Nidana Samyutta, in the Samyutta Nikaya, in the collected discourses of the Buddha, which is only devoted to this subject in itself. So it's something like 50-60 pages only about dependent origination, Paticca Samuppada. Basically, the theory, which also is a fact, exposes that when this is, that also comes to be. When this is not, that also is not. When this arises, that also arises. When this ceases, that also ceases. So it states basically that two things are coupled, that they one has to be there because of, before the other one can emerge. Either they arise and cease simultaneously, or first one is arise and then the other one arise. First the other one sees, then the second one sees. So it's basically a theory about how things come into existence, that they don't exist by themselves. They exist because they are pinned up by other things. Like the trees and plants we see behind us here, they, it's obvious, but basically they do not come out of the blue, so to speak. They have to have circumstances. There has to be a seed. In the case of Buddhism, it's usually karma, but the seed can also be ignorance, can also be craving, it can also be food. It can be many things, basically, that cause the phenomena comes into being. But in the case of trees, there has to be seed, there has to be earth, there has to be water, fertilizer, light and warmth, some temperature, huh, above zero. Then the tree will grow, the plant will grow and flower. If you take just one of them away, for example, if you take water away, there's still sun, there's still earth, there's still nutriment, fertilizer. But if you just take water away, then the trees and all the plants die. Similarly, if you take the sun away, take the light away, then they also die. They cease to exist. Not instantly, but after a while. And the same thing with mental phenomena, and all phenomena actually, also material phenomena, in particular mental phenomena when we look at Buddhism, they also have a cause. They do not spring out of the blue. So this means that both suffering and happiness have a cause. And if we can provide that cause, then happiness will emerge. Which is the same thing is that if you take away the cause of suffering, well, then happiness will emerge, because no suffering equals happiness. So when this exists, that comes to be. With the arising of this, that also arises. When this does not exist, that also does not exist. With the cessation of this, that also ceases. That's basically the tenet. And this is then coupled into 12 links that we will go through in detail. It basically came out from the Buddha's speculation about for a long time during his spiritual education and eventually during his process of enlightenment where he realized it fully. It was that he asked himself, this suffering, how does it come to be? What with the condition by what does suffering comes to be? And then he think, it's aging, sickness and death that makes suffering comes into being. Aging, sickness and death, we can also say aging, decay, sickness and death, can have very many notations because Paticca-samuppada goes on all time scales. It goes from moment to moment, from life to life, from universe to universe. So causes that are planted very long time ago or yesterday or the moment before this one, they will have effect on this present moment. Some causes planted in the universes back, they can still have effect in this moment. So they are overlapping. So this means that Paticca-samuppada is valid on all time scales, not only on the three lives that is usually taught on. So basically it means death of the moment, that is the moment ceases, that you cannot call the past moment back. If this was very joyous and very satisfying, you cannot call it back. And because you cannot call it back, this of course then cause frustration, because then one has to regenerate the joy or the satisfaction or the happiness of the past moment, which can be a difficult task. So it goes on all time scales, goes from life to life, from moment to moment. So death means, in this case, death of the life, death of the physical body, but also death of the moment. And decay means that it slips out of existence, that it decays into something else. Then he asks, how come that there is this decay, sickness and old aging and death? This is because of birth. So why is there death? What's the cause of death? That is conditioned by birth. With birth, jati as condition, this marana, this death comes into being. So birth here means both birth of the body, birth of the life, birth of the being that can also be spontaneous rebirth on a higher level or on a lower level, for example, as ghost or as deva. And because there is this birth, and because whatever comes into existence that is impermanent, that also will cease, this means that it also will cease. Whatever arises, that also ceases. It reminds about Sariputta that actually before he became a disciple of the Buddha, had a teacher, and Moggallana also had a teacher, but they were not satisfied with that teacher, even though he was a fairly good teacher. But nevertheless, Sariputta went out and sought of disciples, and then he saw Asaji, and then he walked around, he was enlightened, and one of the first five disciples, the Panchavagya of the Buddha, which you see here. And so he went after this gentleman and waited until he had collected his alms food, had eaten his alms food, and then he approached him and asked, "Venerable sir, what is your name and so on, and who is your teacher?" And then Asaji, he explained that the Buddha was his teacher. Then please explain to me, Sariputta asked, your teacher's theory. And then Asaji very modestly said that he was only a beginner. So he could not tell it in full, but he could give a short taster of what it was like. And this Sariputta then accepted. And then Asaji said that whatever arises from a cause, this cause has been explained by my teacher. And whatever cause that makes any phenomena cease, that also has been explained by this great sage that is my teacher. And by this, Sariputta instantly recognized that now he has found his teacher, which was Buddha Gautama. So he went back to Mahamoggallana and said, now we have found our teacher. But then they agreed to go to their own teacher first and ask him to come also along. But he said, then his own teacher said, you know, I'm a teacher myself, so I cannot go with you to be a pupil under another teacher, because I'm a senior. So it was because of pride, basically. But it can be like this: those who are stupid, they can come with me, but those who are clever then goes with the Buddha Gautama. So he stayed behind and will not come to learn the Dhamma. But nevertheless, Sariputta and Mahamogayana, they went to the Buddha and became ordained. Back to the chain of origination. So there's this birth, jati. And where does, with what as condition do birth come into existence? If birth comes into existence conditioned by bhava, by becoming, process of becoming. So becoming is basically the dynamics of early Buddhism. That if one moment has the dynamics to become to a new conscious, mental, physical moment, then if there is this, in this being, in particular being is the karma and the latent tendency to still be conscious and still have experience, then there will come a new latent moment, a new conscious moment. And this is called becoming. Similarly, with the birth of the being, if there is a moment of death, if this consciousness at the moment of death contains desire to be conscious, to see something, hear something, taste something, smell something, touch something, or think about something, then there is rebirth. There is this patisanti vijnana, this rebirth consciousness, that then jumps into a new material form corresponding to its karmic constituents or its karmic context. Wherever the probabilities are highest for enfolding itself, there is a possibility for enfolding itself, whether it's in a chicken egg or in the human womb, or is a divine position or at a ghost level, then the consciousness will reemerge there, because basically consciousness, as all other phenomena, has two aspects. One is local and particle-like and thereby local, and one is wave-like and thereby non-local. This just means that it's everywhere present at the same time. So it jumps into and enfolds its particle-like nature at that particular location where the probability fits its own karmic context. That is to say, if the karma has been bad, then it will be a low rebirth. If karma has been good, then it will be a high rebirth. And the same goes on at different positions at the human stage and the different positions at the animal stage and deva stage also. There will be high and low. So basically it's just this becoming that is pushing the time forward in early Buddhism, that makes a conscious moment cease and then a new conscious moment arise. For the Arahant, where there is no urge, no craving, tanha, no thirst, and also no ignorance regarding the fourth noble truth, no spiritual blindness at the death moment, then there will be no next moment, and then there will be nirvana. Because there's no reoccurrence of a body that has to die and become sick and old. So a becoming is, what is then this, this becoming is then driven by what? Bhava can also mean development, and that's actually a good term also. But I think becoming is the best, because it basically means that the train goes on, that it keeps rolling. It does not stand still on the rails, because there's a force of it. It's promulgated by something. That is, discrete promulgation doesn't matter so much. That is more like jumps in time from time point one to the next time point. But it's just that there's a push in the mind to regenerate into a new body and to have new experiences. Why is there this push? Because there is this, deep down, because there's spiritual blindness of the Four Noble Truth. So this means that the beings have an idea that it is possible to experience something else than suffering, or to go somewhere else that is not lead to suffering. And this is because there's this blindness of the First Noble Truth, and also the blindness of the Fourth Noble Truth of the Noble Way, Noble Eightfold Way leading out of suffering. Because it doesn't see that, because it doesn't know that particular consciousness, then when it sees here, then it realizes another place. And this also goes for the consciousness now. There's still ignorance and craving present. Then when one consciousness ceases, then a new consciousness arises. Also because there's a backlog of craving, of mental construction. Nevertheless, when what is the cause of becoming? By what condition comes becoming into being? How does the train has this push? What? How? Where does it get it from? Because of clinging, upadana, which also means feeding. But clinging is probably the best. It can also mean take up something. So because there has been take up of karma, basically of probability, for a long, long time, then this becoming is caused and comes into being. And then the train is set rolling. And it keeps on rolling because there is a continual feeding, because there is a continual clinging to various objects. Usually to cling to sensuality, which is to seeing something, hearing something, smelling something, tasting something, hearing something, feeling something, and experiencing various mental states. For example, as drugged mental states, or the mental states of gladness and satisfaction, and orgasm, for example, is a very common example. So because there is this clinging to that, but also clinging to various views, for example, the clinging to that all religion is foolish, and it's only based on belief and superstition, this can be one clinging. Clinging to the view that science knows everything better, and thereby also it can speak about what is good and bad, which is not the case because it's not within experimental range. Or that after death is nothing. There's no this world, there's no that world, there's no karmic law. Just to mention a few of the clingings to wrong views that can be very deleterious. But also on the other end of the scale, clinging to various rules and rituals. That is to say, if you do this and that, for example, take bath in the Ganges, then you can purify yourself of previous bad karma, previous bad behavior, previous evil action. But this is not the case. Or if you take on a hat or something as funny clothes or a white thread around your wrist, then you become purified. The purification is possible by these means of rituals. This is not the case. So there's this clinging to sensuality, clinging to views, and clinging to rules and rituals. This causes this bhava, this becoming, to come into being. Ah, then we can back up one step further. What then, by what condition does clinging, upadana, come into being? What is the cause of clinging? The cause of clinging is craving, tanha, which is, means thirst basically, of which there is three. There's thirst for sensuality, again, thirst or craving to see something, hear something, smell something, taste something, touch something, and think something or enjoy various mental states. And it is this craving that's caused the clinging. That is to say, first you want it, that is craving, then you, when you got it, sometimes even before you got it, you start clinging to it in order not to lose it. There also the fear comes into being. So it is because of this craving that clinging emerges. What about then if we back up one step further? How does craving come into being? How does this craving, this thirst, this tanha, how does this emerge in the first place? This is because of feeling, vedana. Vedana, because of feeling, which is basically most easy to understand, pleasant feeling, everything that you see, hear, smell, taste, touch, or think, or a various state that you, for example, intoxicated mental state that you enjoy, well, then this calls craving after the same object, or similar object that also can assume to give the same joy or pleasant feeling. So gladness is pleasant feeling of the mind, and pleasure is pleasant feeling or pleasure of the body. Huh? But this is only one side of craving. It is craving towards the object, caused by pleasant feeling. But there's also craving away from the object, to be free from the object, to be free from everything that is connected with pain and everything that is connected with sadness. That is painful feeling of the body, pain in the knee, headache, tooth pain and so on, and sadness, depression, dissatisfaction of the mind. So this will then crave away to be from the object. Mind will then push the object away. And then there's also craving to neglect the object, to have another object from arising from neutral feeling. So all three kinds of feeling, whether pleasant feeling, painful feeling or neutral feeling, that is neither pleasant nor painful, they give rise to craving. Craving towards the object that induces the feeling, craving away from the object, or craving to neglect the object. This is an important relation because right there arise the three mulas, the three root defilements, namely aversion, greed, and ignorance. So greed arises from this pleasant feeling. Then there is a reiteration that if you get the right object, touch the right object, contact the right object, well, then there will be pleasant feeling. So then there's a greed towards this object in particular, but also similar objects that is assumed to induce the same pleasant feeling. Aversion arises, hate, dosa, arises from the opposite, from contact with an unpleasant object, with a mental contact, you think about something, or physical contact with an object. If it arises painful feeling, then one tries to push the object away, to be free from the object. Then hate, aversion arise right there. Ignorance then arises because if there's neither pleasure nor pain connected with contact with an object, then one will tend to neglect the object, skip it over, because mind is scanning for pleasure all the time. Where can I find my next pleasurable moment? Either by feeding something or hearing something or tasting something or touching something, sensing something in general, or enjoying a particular mental state. So the root defilements arise because of being unaware of this feeling arising and this feeling ceasing. So everything converges, the Buddha say, on feeling, Vedana. What then does this feeling arise from? Yeah, this arises from contact, passa, from contact. And how is contact defined? Yes, if there's a visual object and there's something that can see, an eye is usually the name, but actually it's ability to see. If there's ability to see and there's a visual object that has either a color or a form, then visual consciousness arises. The coincidence or the co-occurrence of visual object, eye, and visual consciousness, this is contact. And similar with the ear. If there's a sound to be heard and an ear to hear, then auditory consciousness, hearing consciousness arises. The co-occurrence at the same moment of these three, the sound, the ear, and auditory consciousness, is auditory contact. Similarly with other senses, but also with the mind, if there's a mental object, an idea, or a mental state to be perceived, there is a mind to perceive them, then mental consciousness arises right there. The co-occurrence or coincidence or meeting together of these three, idea, mind, and mental consciousness, this is mental contact. Mental contact. Because of this contact, Vedana, feeling arise. Because of feeling arise in craving. Because of craving, clinging. Because of clinging, becoming. Because of becoming, birth. Because of birth, aging, sickness, and death. And because of aging, sickness, and death, suffering. So is the arising of this whole mass of suffering. So a really central point is the contact with the world, that the contact with the world perceive inherently, automatically, inevitably leads to suffering because it leads to aging. This is important to understand, because if this is the case, then one realizes that it's not a matter of getting a new contact. It's not a matter of getting a new car, a new lover, or go to a new travel destination, or getting a new life, getting a new body, getting plastic surgery, for example, getting a new job. Samsara, wherever, at whatever level, whether high or low, cannot be bended, cannot be repaired. So not to end with suffering, because of this, its impermanence, because it always ends with this aging, sickness and death, both of the moment ceases, but also of the body, and also of the mental state. But then, eventually there will be reoccurrence. This going in circles is basically the round, the vata of mental defilements. That is basically the hindrances, sense desire, ill will, laziness and letargy, restlessness and regret and doubt and uncertainty, the nivaranas, the five hindrances, that kind of like blind, spiritually blind the being from seeing the Four Noble Truths of suffering, that all this is suffering, inevitably and absolutely, which then makes the being turn towards nirvana, turn towards the light, to find something else, an alternative that is real and is a fact. It's not a spiritual fantasy. And then also to see the second noble truth of the cause of suffering, which is craving, and the third noble truth of the absence of craving then entails absence of suffering, and the fourth noble truth of the Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering by cutting out craving, craving for sensuality, craving for becoming, and craving for non-becoming. Bhavatanna, craving for becoming, will mean, will cover craving for becoming rich, craving for becoming young, craving for becoming beautiful, craving for becoming famous, respected, praised. Vibhavatanna, craving for non-becoming, covers craving for not becoming dead, not becoming disrespected, not becoming old, not becoming sick, not becoming ugly, not becoming stupid. So all this craving then leads to suffering. If there's no craving, then there will be no suffering. So if we go back to the chain of coordination where we now have reached a contact, that this contact inevitably, which is basically, seems to be very innocent, then one can ask, how does contact come about? How does a conscious being get contact with the world? Yeah, then obviously it's the six senses. The ability to see, hear, smell, taste, touch, and think. It is by that the conscious being comes into being and comes into contact with the world. So the six senses, which usually is perceived, and this is one mental fermentation, one asava, I think the prime one actually, this is mental assumption, mental fermentation, mental conception of that sensing always entails pleasure, which is not the case. Sensing can in many cases entail pain, and in many cases, in most cases, I will say it entails neutral feeling, neither pleasure nor pain. But nevertheless, it seems so innocent, especially out here in the forest where the birds are singing and there's green leaves all over the place. It seems so innocent to come into contact with the world. But eventually, because of this contact causes feeling, because feeling causes craving, because this craving causes clinging, because clinging causes becoming, and because becoming always leads to birth, aging, sickness and death, then it inevitably leads up to, ends with, produces, causes suffering to emerge later down the road, if not instantly. So the six senses, the inputs, so to speak, was better silenced completely, completely. Because then the suffering will not emerge. However, it is not here one can cut the chain. Because if you have a body and you have the six senses, well, there will be sense inputs. Unless you go to the first Arupa Jhana, then to cut off all sense impingement, the first formless jhana, in deep state of meditation, but nevertheless that also is an impermanent state, so it's not a final solution to the problem. But then eventually there will come sense input that then will provoke feeling. However, there is one place one can cut if the being, especially the arahant, is aware of feeling arising and feeling ceasing in each particular moment, each consecutive moment, whether it's pleasant feeling, painful feeling, or neutral feeling, then he or she sees it arise and see it cease. Then this is awareness can decouple the coupling between feeling and craving. That is to say, in unaware case, when feeling arises, craving also arises. When feeling ceases, craving also ceases. But then a new feeling arises, a new craving arises. So every time craving arises, there's some probability for becoming stored, accumulated, some karma accumulated. Because craving basically is karmically active, it forms intentions that it wants this or that, it wants to do this and that, it wants to turn this attention to this and that. And because of that, there's this accumulation of probability for re-becoming later down the road. So, sense input is by no means neither innocent nor karmically inactive. By no means. Again, sense input contact, passa, is caught by the six senses. The ability to see, the visual sense, the ability to hear, the auditory sense, the ability to smell and taste, the gustatory and olfactory sense, the tactile sense, the ability to touch and feel where your limbs are bent or stretched, and the ability to think and experience mental states. Okay, then what then is cause and condition for this six senses to arise? This is something called name and form in early Buddhism, nama and rupa, which is a reoccurrence of a physical appearance and some consciousness. So rupa means form, that which can break up is basically the direct translation of rupa, that which rupanti can break up, like this physical form, the body basically. This also goes for divine bodies and for bodies at any lower stage. Even bodies made of light, they also can break up because they are held together by clinging. The molecules are collected together by this clinging to this body itself, but also to whatever this body can come to experience and sense. So this name and form, this nama rupa, this naming and forming, producing a physical body by clinging to it basically, and keep on clinging to it, and having a store of probability for the body, for the molecules to reoccur in each particular blink of time. This is producing it. What about name? Mind, basically, nama can also, it means naming, designating external and internal phenomena. It is one thing, the prime role of mind, but it is also described as a cyclical process between attention, contact, feeling, perception, and craving. So these five things. So imagine there is a new contact we have here. Then this contact causes feeling. Then this causes perception. Then this causes craving or intention. And because there is intention, then attention will be redirected according to this intention, whether this intention wants to experience this or it wants to experience that. Then there's a redirection of attention. When there's a redirection of attention, then a new contact arises, a new sense contact, then a new feeling, a new perception, and a new intention arise. So it's a cyclical process between these five phenomena. of intention, attention, contact, feeling and perception. And then new intention, contact, attention, feeling and perception. So it keeps going around. This is basically mind, that is cyclical, running around in a process where it hunts after one object after the other, conditioned by whatever craving, usually looking after pleasure. If this object doesn't give pleasure, then it wants to perceive a new object. Or if this object gave pleasure, then it wants to perceive the same object again, or a similar object, to get a new moment of pleasure, then to get a new moment of satisfaction, a new moment of peace, and then a new moment of happiness. But as soon as this is over, then it wants, has to regenerate it again, because as soon as the contact is lost with the object, after one moment of perceiving it, well, then the feeling is also lost, and then the happiness is also lost, and then it has to, one has to search up a new contact. By the redirecting attention to a new object or the same object. So this name and form, body and mind, mentality and materiality, whether individual or collective, but in most cases, most easy to understand in the individual case, this mentality and this materiality, which is properties, not entities, these properties then keep promulgating, they keep re-arising again and again. Why do they re-arise? By what condition, what circumstance, what cause do name and form comes to be? Yes, that's actually most easy to understand by looking at the rebirth moment. But since we are time are discrete and it's blinking, then we are reborn billions of times, probably one time per Planck moment, which is 10 to the minus 43 seconds. That is to say 100,000 billion times per second we are reborn. But it's most easy to understand in the case of normal rebirth, in the case of biological death and then rebirth in the next life. Because their consciousness is causing this name and form. And this is, you have the egg inside the womb in the case of the human rebirth. You have the spermatozoa that has to meet the egg. But then the Buddhist points out that if not the Padisanti, the Gandhapa consciousness, also emerges into this egg. And this is seen from, if you see from the Gandhapa being, the being that is going to be reborn, then they will, in the moment immediately after their death moment, their chuti moment, in the Padisanti, then the Padisanti consciousness, the object of their consciousness, will see their mother and father having sex and will then feel a irresistible desire to be inside the womb of what will be their mother. And right after this, for this disembodied consciousness, this desire is formed, then they are emerge in the womb, in the egg, where they will be in a form of sleep state, a very low subconscious level of consciousness. That is nevertheless not, it's like a very dreamlike, but nevertheless without dreams, sleep-like state, where consciousness is still going on, called the bhavanga. So it's a consciousness that's kind of like reoccurring and is very weak. But as the fetus grow, then and becomes larger and larger, and there's a nerve cell specialized, and then eventually it will specialize out into visual consciousness, tactile consciousness, and so on. So it's still there. The Buddha says that if this consciousness doesn't go into the egg and the sperm cell, so there's a unification of three things: the egg, the sperm cell, and the consciousness, the Padisanti Vijnana, the rebirth linking consciousness. If these three doesn't meet, then even though the egg meets the sperm cell, then it will go out. And this we know as doctors actually happens in 2/3 of the cases. In 67% of the cases, the egg, even though it's fertilized up in the tuba uterina, up in close to the womb, but after, before the womb arrives, before the egg arrives in the womb, there it's fertilized. But if it's not, it doesn't meet consciousness, then it will go out with the menstruation. It will not hatch to the uterine wall and then grow into a full-born pregnancy. It will go out with the menstruation as a fertilized egg that nevertheless do not develop beyond the morula stage of 32 cells. So it's a fertilized egg, two-thirds of the fertilized eggs, they actually is discarded again. And this fits or is consistent, I would say, with Buddhist explanation that if no consciousness is present, then biology is not enough to make a nama rupa. Basically, because there's only rupa, there's only biological form, there's no consciousness present. And so this means that the consciousness actually is the cause of this name and form, this mentality and materiality, this body and mind emerging at the moment of birth, thereby taking with it the six senses, and thereby coming into contact with the world, thereby setting this cycle of re-arising feeling, re-arising craving, re-arising becoming, re-arising clinging, re-arising becoming, re-arising birth, aging, sickness and death, and thereby re-arising suffering. Thereby this set this cycle, cyclic reoccurrence, set this going. If we back up again, even further, if we go into the past life, what actually was the cause of this consciousness coming into being? This actually is mental construction, sankhara, that you form intentions about doing this and that in the former life. And these intentions then produce this bhava and produce this becoming that there was in the prior life. And thereby also at the moment of death, this is promulgated into a consciousness that jumps to the next body. So if there's no karma left on the tank, no karmic accumulation left on the tank for the arahat being, and there's nothing in the rebirth moment that is promulgating a new rebirth, then there will be no rebirth. There will be no re-emergence. So it is because of this construction or this volitional formations is also a translation that is used for mental constructions. Basically, they arise from what? Why is mental construction arise, mental formation, putting together intentions, putting together will, putting together wanting, putting together thirst after this and that, putting together dreaming, planning, hoping, and so forth? Why is it coming to emergence? It becomes into emergence because of ignorance, because of spiritual blindness, because of not knowing the Four Noble Truths. It is because of that. Why is it so? Because no being that has full knowledge, full realization of the Four Noble Truths would form mental construction to go back into samsara, go back into the world. Why no? Why not? Because it knows it's suffering. It's going back into suffering. That will never go. It'll back out and say, I stay here because this is happiness. I don't go into a new body because then I have to die. Then I have to become old. I don't form new intentions because then I have to experience the result of these intentions later down the road. I don't prolong samsara. And to see this, to realize this is something that comes very slow. Actually, it comes in four steps. The stream entra has seen some level of the Four Noble Truths. The once returner, the Sakadagami, has seen more, 50% of the Four Noble Truths. The Anagami, the never returner, doesn't come back here to this planet Earth. They have seen it 75% fair and square, and the arahat has seen it to a full extent. So it usually is something that one uses several lives, many lives, because of habitual latent tendencies to seek pleasant object, run away from unpleasant object, and then neglect that everything else that is neither pleasant nor painful. What then, if we go the other way around? If we now cease, if this ignorance cease, that has ceased for the arahant, that it's the arahant know for sure that all this and all this and all this that will be into the future, an endless future, this will only be suffering. dukkha. It will be bad states. Dukkha, bad states. Well, then that will be formed. There's no assumption, there's no hoping, there's no planning for experiencing this or that, or for re-becoming this or that. It doesn't occur. This planning, this mental construction, this putting together of assumption. If I plan it like this, or if I bend it like this, or if I navigate like this, then I can reach eternal happiness, lasting happiness. It doesn't occur. It doesn't occur for the Arahant. Why not? Because there is this reminderless ceasing of ignorance, avidya. This spiritual blindness has ceased. It is not there anymore. And this means that there is no craving. There's no craving for becoming. There's no craving for non-becoming either. There's no craving for seeing anything, hearing anything, tasting anything, touching anything, smelling anything, having any mental states. The Buddha once asked a dying monk about this, whether there was in him still present. He was sick and lying there. And then the Buddha asked, do you want to see anything? No, whatever. Sir. Do you want to hear anything? No. Do you still want to taste or touch anything? No. Do you want to smell anything? Do you want to enjoy any mental states or think any particular thought? No, whenever, sir. Then you're ready to go, he said. It is because there is still this craving, whether one is conscious about it or realize it or not, then this craving will then promote or result in clinging, upadana, which can also be seen as take-up or as feeding. Feeding on future, producing future because of this becoming. So, if in the death moment, and in any moment actually, but in particular in the death moment, there is no ignorance, then there's no mental assumption, there's no intention formed, there's no planning, there's no volitional formations, there's no putting together of any future. Because of not putting together any future, because of not hoping, planning, intending, willing, wanting, thirsting after anything, not urging after anything, not wanting anything, then no consciousness arises at the moment of rebirth, that is to say, when the dying being and then the other die, there will be no emergence into another egg and cell, triplet. And this means that no name and form, no new body and mind will be formed. And similarly also, from moment to moment. In this case, let's say this monk didn't have any craving to be in existence, to sense, and to have various ideas, and perform various activities, such as making YouTube videos, for example, but not exclusively. This would not, then no next moment will rearise. If all the prior probabilities of prior already having occurred, craving and clinging from past time in this life and from past time in other lives, this all has been burned up, this all has been exhausted, well, then there'll be no reoccurrence of a conscious body and mind continuum. Then there will be the event of entry into Parinibbana instantaneously. So it's because of this ignorance that mental construction arises, sankhara. And it's because of this mental construction, these volitional formations, that consciousness arises. Because of consciousness arises, reoccur here in this body and mind, and in the particular in the womb, at the moment of rebirth, well, then this body and mind, this name and form, this mentality and materiality, this nama and rupa, this naming and forming, activities, not entities, they reoccur. So when this body and mind reoccur at the moment of birth, both rebirth biologically and also rebirth in every moment here, in this life continuum, well, then there is inherently the six senses, because this body, if it's complete, then it comes out with ear and eye and nose and tongue and tactile abilities in the skin and in the joints and a mind to think with. And so the six senses will arise right there. Because of the six senses, there will be contact. Again, passa, contact with the world. Visual contact, auditory contact, gustatory contact, olfactory contact, smelling contact, tactile contact, and mental contact with the world or with ideas, internal ideas, or mental states. Because of this contact, there will be feeling arise, vedana. But if there's no contact, if there's no name and form, if there's no six senses, with the cessation of this name and forming, this name and form, this body and mind, with the cessation of this body and mind, there is no six senses. If there is no six senses, how can there ever be contact with anything whatsoever? There cannot be. It cannot be. It cannot come into being. This should not be seen as some kind of absence or lack of. It should be a deficiency. It should rather be seen as silence, as absence of disturbance, as cessation, nirodha, ceasing, complete peace. So when there is this complete peace, this complete silence, this complete absence of sense contact, because the six senses is not there, well then, there cannot be any feeling. There cannot be any pleasant feeling, any painful feeling, nor can there be any neutral feeling. So with the cessation, conditioned by this cessation, this ceasing, this silencing of all feeling, there cannot be any craving. There cannot be any craving. Neither any craving towards something that is pleasant, nor any craving away from anything that is painful, nor any craving towards something new, ever reoccurring. Zap, 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 zap. Blader, blader, blader on your mobile phone. News, new news, new soda news. That cannot be. That cannot be. So this absence of feeling, which is very, very nice. Imagine, I think most meditators have tried it. That suddenly there is this silence where there's no thought, but also when there's no, so there's no sensation. You cannot feel your body. At the same time, you have no feeling. There might be a pleasant feeling in the mind, but even that can kind of like fizzle out. So there is no feeling either. It's usually an illusion that there will be some subtle level of feeling. There will also be some subtle level of perception. But nevertheless, to whatever degree one has experienced this cessation of perception and feeling, this silencing of it, to however much it has been reduced, then it's felt as very, very agreeable. Very, very agreeable. It is not felt as a deficiency. It is not felt as an absence of something, that something is lacking. Actually, something undefinable, peaceful, undefinable, excellent, unconstructed, equanimity, serenity, peace is felt, which is higher than anything else. Also because it is not felt as being impermanent at that particular moment, though it is. So this means that the absence of sensation, the absence of feeling, is pointing towards the unconstructed state, nibbana, the unconditioned state, nibbana, which is the highest happiness. Because it's another happiness caused by an object. It is caused by sheer nothingness itself, unconditioned state. So one should not be afraid of nibbana. One should not be afraid not to sense anything. One should not be afraid of not being raped by one's own feelings, emotions of pleasure, pain, gladness and sadness, and neutral feeling of boredom eventually in each moment, not being driven around by this invisible hand of changing emotions. One should not be afraid of being free from that, because that is only one thing, suffering. So by the absence, conditioned by the absence, the silencing, the ceasing of all feeling, there is the absence, the ceasing, the silencing of all craving. All craving for sensing something, all craving for becoming something, all craving for not becoming something. So this craving, this absence of this push and pull in the mind, is experienced as peace, as something very precious, as something very silent, as something very solid, as something that a true alternative to running around in samsara. Absence of craving. If there's absence of craving, conditioned by this absence of craving, there will be absence of clinging. If you don't want anything, then there's no need to cling to anything. Then one can spontaneously let anything go. One doesn't need it anymore. One doesn't urge it anymore. And if it's there, then it's okay it's there. One doesn't want to push it away anymore. So in this absence of clinging, there will be absence of becoming, conditioned by this absence of clinging to an object, whether it's internal or external, whether it's past, present or future. Then there will be absence of becoming. This means there will be no push or pull in the mind to regenerate a new moment, a new conscious moment, a new material moment. There will not be. Because of this absence of becoming, there will be absence of birth, birth of the next moment and birth of the next life and birth of the next body. When there is no birth, importantly, there cannot be any old age, decay, sickness and death. There cannot be. So conditioned or caused by this absence of birth, of rebirth, of rebecoming, this absence of the wheel running around, of the train of becoming going down the rail of samsara, eventually running in very large circles, conditioned by this absence of this becoming, there is no birth. When there is no birth, there cannot be. It is impossible that there in the future will become any aging, sickness and death. And this, only this, is the end, the irreversible end of all suffering. The absence of aging, sickness and death. That is the end of suffering. And so is ceasing, the irreversible cessation of this whole mass of suffering that all beings is running around in samsara, and which was the original cause for Buddha saying to himself, there is this, all these beings and all these 31 levels of existence, from hell to ghost to demon to human to animal to divine being to Brahma level being, they're all caused by this ignorance to run around in this samsara. They're all caught up by suffering. How can there be the end of suffering? All the suffering there is in the entire universe. And this led him to follow this chain of causality back. Again, by the absence of ignorance, there will be the absence of mental construction, sankhara. By the absence of mental construction, conditioned by this absence of mental construction, there will be the absence of consciousness. There will be no rebirth consciousness. By the absence of this rebirth consciousness, there will be no naming and form, no name and form, no nama rupa, no mentality and materiality, no baby coming out. By the absence of this name and form, this body and mind, this mentality and materiality, this nama rupa, there will be no six senses. by the absence of these six senses, there will be the cessation, the complete end of all contact, all sense contact. By the absence of this contact, there will be absence of all feeling, silencing all feeling. Conditioned by this absence of feeling, there will be no craving. No craving for sensuality, no craving for becoming, no craving for not becoming, this and that. By absence of no craving for sensing something, or for becoming something, or for not becoming something, there will be an absence or a silence or stillness of this birth. No becoming means no birth. If there's no birth, then there cannot be, again, there cannot be any aging, sickness and death. And so is the cessation of this whole mass of suffering. Thank you. So I hope this clearly expounds, and this is basically from the Nidana Vakya, basically means the chapter on the causes or causation from the Samyutta Nikaya, the connected discourses of the Buddha, which you see here, which I can highly recommend. And this is a core teaching which coincides with Western science on a very core concept of causality. That when this is, that also arises. When this ceases, that also ceases. If there's absence of it, that, there will also be absence of that. So phenomena doesn't stand alone. So many words were the words for today. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. First of all, to the regular donors that we give every month, but also those who give here and there. Dana Parami, the perfection of generosity, is important, and it is how these videos and this promulgation of the Dhamma has continued over 25 centuries and will continue even 25 centuries more before the Sasana eventually is lost. And this explanation of how the cause of suffering comes to be, and the cause of happiness, namely the absence of suffering, also comes to be, this also will be lost. So thank you for your support, and please keep up your supporting. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. Thank you, and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.